I hear robins a great way off, and wagons a great way off, and rivers a great way off, and all appear to be hurrying somewhere undisclosed to me. Remoteness is the founder of sweetness. Could we see all we hope, or hear the whole we fear told tranquil, like another tale, there would be madness near. Each of us gives or takes heaven in corporeal person. For each of us has the skill of life.
I think we have much to be thankful for that Emily Dickinson wrote the way she did. That she was free, that she didn't have an editor to say, come, Miss Dickinson, you can't get away with that. Or a critic to scold. No, she wrote for herself and therefore she was free. She wasn't tied to any restlessness in her spirit. She was content to stay where she was and do justice to what she saw from her point of vision, which was by and large her second story room.
The only image we have of Emily Dickinson is a daguerreotype that she sat for in 1848 as a student at the Mount Holyoke Female Seminary. The daguerreotype, like Dickinson's poetry, was later retouched by editors who added a blush and curls. Emily Dickinson wrote 1,775 poems. 11 were published in her lifetime, all anonymously. The first volume of her work appeared 4 years after her death. It quickly sold through 11 editions and provoked great curiosity about the character of the poet. She was known only as a spinster, a lawyer's daughter, who had spent her entire life in Amherst, Massachusetts, and most of it in her own room. If I read a book and it makes my whole body so cold, no fire can ever warm me, I know that is poetry. If I feel physically as if the top of my head were taken off, I know that is poetry. These are the only ways I know it. Is there any other way?
There are, first of all, a lot of things that are obscure about Emily Dickinson. There's so much about her life we don't know for all the data. In some ways, she's as mysterious to us, I guess, as Shakespeare, about whom we have a good deal less in the way of information.
All the stereotypes that they can try to fit her into, the mad woman in the attic, the mad woman immured in the house, the fey ethereal person in the white dress flitting above stairs when company comes, the childlike presence that is somehow controlling the household. Somehow she has to be fey, strange, cracked.
I mean, this little flower, this fragile person of Amherst, the New England nun, the rose among the roses. No, that won't do. She is a poet who looked very deep and saw very clear.
My life had stood a loaded gun. In corners, till a day the owner passed, identified, and carried me away.
They're very difficult to read because the punctuation is unconventional. That's just the beginning of it. One doesn't, in fact, know sometimes where the emphasis is to go, where the pauses really go. They don't always go where the dashes are.
And do I smile such cordial light upon the valley glow? It is as a Vesuvian face had let its pleasure through. And when at night, our good day done, I guard my master's head, 'tis better than the eider duck's deep pillow to have shared.
Words had the power to kill, she knew that. Also, they had the power to redeem, she knew that, and exalt.
Though I than he may longer live, he longer must than I. For I have but the power to kill without the power to die.
What I learned from her was that there are extreme psychological states which can be hunted down in language and which can receive embodiment in language. But that language has to be forged, it has to be created. It isn't just found in the air. It's not the first words that come to mind.
Emily Dickinson is just one of the incontestable geniuses in the English language, that almost any life she led would have been probably the life that would have allowed her to create the work. And that genius has a way of employing what is close at hand, you know, in terms of the long range. So I think it happened that she stayed at home. There may be another Emily Dickinson, you know, in some fantasy world, who, like George Eliot, whom she admired, you know, went out into the world and did other things. But she found her way of dealing with the demands of life by staying in what she called her father's house. She was always inclined to speak of my father's house. I think she was very fortunate in the accidents of her life because she did come from a fairly affluent and well-established family, so that she wasn't forced to marry just for economic reasons. The fact that she could live at home and have a sort of systematic privacy, there is all comfort in what some see as the numbing routines of domestic life. There's a real schedule there, and this allowed her to write, you know, in the crevices, so to speak, of that schedule.
This was a poet. It is that distills amazing sense from ordinary meanings, and attar so immense from the familiar species that perished by the door. We wonder it was not ourselves arrested it before. Of pictures, the discloser, the poet it is he, entitles us by contrast to ceaseless poverty of portion, so unconscious. The robbing could not harm himself to him, a fortune exterior to time.
She was in that great Puritan tradition of keeping diaries. That was one of their ways of keeping their thumbs on the spiritual pulse. Day by day, their moods change. In a way, that's the way Emily Dickinson, it seems to me, wrote her poems. She kept a pretty good eye on what was happening inside and wrote poem after poem, day after day. Actually, what we have is a poet's workshop.
Dickinson had a strong and complex attachment to her family. Her father, Edward Dickinson, was a powerful figure who inspired Emily's reverence, but also her rebellion. She was particularly close to her older brother, Austin, although she competed with him. Their mother, Emily Norcross Dickinson, was a shadowy figure, an invalid who left the running of the household to her daughters. Vinnie, the youngest, adored Emily, but like the others, found her bewildering.
I never had a mother. I suppose a mother is one to whom you hurry when you are troubled. Mother's dear little wants do engross the time. To read to her, to fan her, to explain why the grasshopper is a burden. We were never intimate, mother and children, while she was our mother. But minds in the same ground meet by tunneling. And when she became our child, the affection came. Austin is a poet. Austin writes a psalm. Now, brother Pegasus, I've been in the habit of writing some few things, and it rather appears to me that you're getting away with my patent. Dear Austin, I am keen, but you are a good deal keener. I am something of a fox, but you are more of a hound. I guess we are very good friends, though. Vinny, I would like more sisters, that the taking out of one might not leave such stillness. Vinny has been all so long. I feel the oddest fright at parting with her for an hour, lest a storm arise and I go unsheltered. Vinny, it is so great and vastly mysterious. The tie is quite vital. Yet if we had come from two wells where we had hitherto been bred, her astonishment would not be greater at some things I say. In fugitive moments when he forgets the barrister and lapses into the man, father says that his life has been passed in a wilderness or on an island. And so it is, for in the morning I hear his voice, and methinks it comes from afar and has a sea tone, and there is a hum of hoarseness about it, and a suggestion of remoteness as far as the Isle of Juan Fernandez. We do not have much poetry at home. Father having made up his mind that it's pretty much all real life, his real life and mine sometimes come into collision.
Vesuvius at home. That's her phrase. I think it describes very well how she perceived herself, experienced herself a great deal of the time. A volcano, a force of nature with tremendous destructive potential in the house and buildings.
She had a sense of her own genius, but like all genius, she couldn't be certain of controlling it. The Vesuvius at home, while it sounds powerful and positive, is also the Vesuvius that drives Van Gogh insane or preys upon Kafka. You know, it's also the dark night of the soul, so that like riding a great wave, you know, one can't control it.
I think her poetry is very often an exploration of a kind of dynamic between control of that force and chaos, the potential for chaos.
I felt a funeral in my brain, and mourners to and fro kept treading, treading, till it seemed that sense was breaking through. And when they all were seated, a service like a drum kept beating, beating, till I thought my mind was going numb. And then I heard them lift a box and creak across my soul with those same boots of lead again. Then space began to toll, as all the heavens were a bell, and being but an ear, and I and silence, some strange race, wrecked solitary here. And then a plank in reason broke, and I dropped down and down, and hit a world at every plunge, and finished knowing then.
If you read Dickinson against the background of the so-called poetesses of the 19th century, of the American 19th century, the poets, the women poets whose works were being published in magazines and anthologies, you really understand what a departure she was and why, although there were many women poets writing, she must have felt herself to be so outside of that convention, that tradition.
The images of women that were advanced in the work, in some ways the antithesis of what we would think of as a normal, healthy, you know, human being, very, very soft, very pliant, very emotional, and completely under the thumb of any male, you know, who's close by, but usually the husband or the father, defined only within this patriarchal society. So I read some of these novels, or tried to, the romances that begin around the 1850s or so. And the image of women is entirely in terms of Christian submission, that the husband or father is a kind of stand-in for God, or maybe God is a stand-in for the husband and father.
She used to read all the wretched sentimental novels that were popular in the day, but she also read Sir Thomas Browne, who's not easy to read, and she read Keats and Mrs. Browning, and she was very fond of George Eliot.
She's, in some ways, I think, more like the metaphysicals. You find her using the terminology of science, of the carpenter, of things in the world around her as metaphors for being, for experience, for feeling, for psychic states.
Dare you see a soul at the white heat, then crouch within the door. Red is the fire's common tint, but when the vivid ore has vanquished flame's conditions, it quivers from the forge without a color but the light of unanointed blaze. Least village has its blacksmith, whose anvil's even ring stands symbol for the finer forge that soundless tugs within, refining these impatient ores with hammer and with blaze, until the designated light repudiate the forge.
At 16, Emily Dickinson left Amherst to enter college at the Mount Holyoke Female Seminary, 7 miles away. A goal of its founder, Mary Lyon, was to turn out women missionaries, not poets, and she fired her students' spiritual ambitions. "We have great powers within us," she told them. "We may become what we will." Dickinson had already received an unusually rigorous education in her 7 years at the Amherst Academy. In addition to languages, history, English literature, and the classics, nearly half her courses were in the sciences.
5 days have now passed since we returned to Holyoke. There are not many wildflowers near, for the girls have driven them to a distance, and we are obliged to walk to find them. The trailing arbutus, adder's tongue, yellow violets, liverleaf, bloodroot. When much in the woods as a little girl, I was told that the snake would bite me, that I might pick a poisonous flower, or goblins kidnap me. But I went along and met no one but angels. So I haven't that confidence in fraud which many exercise.
She saw nature much more realistically. The blonde assassin, she called the frost, killed her plants with impunity. Nature was apart from her. She could not fuse herself with the landscape, someone else has said, of romantic nature poetry. Nature was here and she was there. She knew a lot more about it scientifically than most of her fellow romantics. Her early studies under the aegis of the great Dr. Edward Hitchcock, the most prominent geologist of his day. She was a great botanist. She was a bit of a geologist. She knew the stars. And I think that gave her a sense of reality. It founded her nature poetry on a firmer basis than most of her contemporaries.
The Dickinsons were pure-blooded Puritans, but their religious orthodoxy did not conflict with a deep respect for scientific fact. The closer you looked at things, they believed, in a field or in a laboratory, the better you could love God. It was, ironically, the religious discipline of her community that gave Dickinson the means to think, and with it, the means to doubt. She refused, with an almost modern skepticism, to take anything on faith alone.
This world is not conclusion. A species stands beyond, invisible as music, but positive as sound. It beckons and it baffles, philosophy, don't know, and through a riddle at the last, sagacity must go. To guess it puzzles scholars, to gain it men have borne contempt of generations and crucifixion shown. Faith slips and laughs and rallies, blushes if any see, plucks at a twig of evidence and asks of vain the way. Much gesture from the pulpit, strong hallelujahs roll. Narcotics cannot still the tooth that nibbles at the soul.
When she was 16, the seminary at Mount Holyoke, she entered in a class of 235-odd students that were divided roughly into three equal sections, those who were acknowledged as professing Christians, those who had hope of becoming so, and those who were, in fact, without hope. And by December of that first academic year, the last group had been reduced to 25, and she was among them.
2 years after Mount Holyoke, Dickinson still spoke of standing in rebellion.
Christ is calling everyone here. All my companions have answered. Even my darling Vinnie believes she loves and trusts him. And I am standing alone in rebellion and growing very careless. I am one of the lingering bad ones. And so do I slink away and pause and ponder and ponder and pause. I tremble when I think how soon the weeks and days of this term will all have been spent, and my fate will be sealed, perhaps. It is not now too late, so my friends tell me, so my offended conscience whispers, but it is hard for me to give up the world.
There were numerous revivals going on in the New England countryside around her, and Ian Amherst, from the time she was, I think, about 18 years old and refused to stand up in church and say that she wanted to be saved.
And it may very well be that Emily Dickinson, whatever else that may be said about her, being an extraordinarily honest woman, refused to fake any of this, and out of that extraordinary integrity found herself, in the eyes of her community, outcast. Her decision then was either to believe that she was indeed damned, which was to accept conventional orthodox belief, or to believe, as I suspect she did, that she may have been more honest than anyone else.
Hers was a sort of tragic Christianity. She never joined the church, incidentally, and she never went to church after, about age 30, and this in a town where it was very noticeable if a daughter or a child of a prominent family didn't join the church and didn't attend divine worship.
Somewhere around the age of 30, she adopted her so-called white habit. She became a recluse, devoted to some mode of existence that was largely a poetic one.
I'm seated. I've stopped being theirs. The name they dropped upon my face with water in the country church is finished using now, and they can put it with my dolls, my childhood, and the string of spools I've finished threading, too. Baptized before, without the choice, but this time consciously of grace, unto supremest name, call to my full, the crescent dropped, existence's whole arc filled up with one small diadem. My second rank, too small the first, crowned, crowing, on my father's breast, a half-unconscious queen, but this time adequate, erect, with will to choose or to reject, and I choose just a crown.
The hymn meter was in Dickinson's blood, a basic rhythm, a sort of drumbeat. She used and transformed this orthodox structure in many poems to express unorthodox ideas.
The hymns are characterized almost always by very distinct pauses at the ends of lines. This is necessary for a congregation to sing. You don't have a breath that lasts forever unless you're Pavarotti, so that for the ordinary congregation, it would be useful to be able to stop at the end of a line and then start. And this governs the syntax, governs the whole grammatical structure. Emily Dickinson did not observe those strictures at all. She wrote poems that move with great rapidity through very considerable numbers of lines without any logical or syntactical pause. So she violates the integrity of the hymnal form, I think, with a great deal of force.
Of all the sounds dispatched abroad, there's not a charge to me like that old measure in the boughs, that phraseless melody the wind does working like a hand whose fingers comb the sky, then quiver down with tufts of tune, permitted gods and me. When winds go round and round in bands and thrum upon the door, and birds take places overhead to bear them orchestra, I crave him grace of summer boughs, if such an outcast be, who never heard that fleshless chant rise solemn on the tree, as if some caravan of sound off deserts in the sky had parted rank, then knit and swept in seamless company.
Religion offered Emily Dickinson's contemporaries in Amherst the consolation of an unshakable belief in the afterlife. Dickinson sometimes yearned for such simple reassurance, and sometimes spurned it proudly, but she didn't share it. Immortality was, as she put it, the flood subject. In one of her greatest poems, Safe in Their Alabaster Chambers, she imagines death in sensuous and ironic terms.
Safe in their alabaster chambers, untouched by morning and untouched by noon, lie the meek members of the resurrection, rafter of satin and roof of stone. Grand go the years in the crescent above them. Worlds scoop their arcs and firmaments row. Diadems drop and doges surrender, soundless as dots on a disk of snow.
Remember that in the mid-19th century, death was an ever-present fact in even quiet New England village life. When she was 17 or 18, some five of her best friends died of consumption, they called it in those days, tuberculosis. They had no defense against it, one after another. At a point, her room looked out over the cemetery, and she saw funeral after funeral. Nowadays, we are cushioned. We are insulated from a lot of that. Not Emily Dickinson. When you said in those days, how are you today, you meant it. It wasn't just for form. How are you feeling? Because tomorrow, you might be gone.
There's a great deal of doubt in Emily Dickinson's part. She is by no means convinced that she will ever survive. And the poems are, in fact, often about death. She writes not from the perspective alone of the living, but often from the perspective of the dead. I died for beauty is the beginning of a poem in which, and the whole thing takes place inside a mausoleum, inside a tomb. And she writes as though she knows better than any of us what it's like to be dead.
I died for beauty, but was scarce adjusted in the tomb, when one who died for truth was lain in an adjoining room. He questioned softly why I failed, For beauty, I replied, and I for truth, himself are one. We brethren are, he said. And so, as kinsmen met a night, we talked between the rooms, until the moss had reached our lips and covered up our names.
Amherst, Massachusetts in the 1850s was a farm town, despite the presence of the college. The village green was still a rough pasture with birch trees and a frog pond. The cattle show was as big an event as commencement. The Dickinson family had been prominent in the business, social, and religious life of Amherst and Hampshire County for five generations. Her grandfather had helped to found Amherst College in 1821, and her father Edward was a leading lawyer and a tireless promoter of progress for the community. He helped to build the waterworks and bring the railroad, and in 1854 he served in Congress. Emily's brother, Austin, followed their father as treasurer of Amherst College and was a founder of the First Church. His formidable wife, Sue, was an arbiter of style and culture. Miss Emily could easily have spent her life receiving and paying calls. Instead, she chose to secure her privacy against the intrusion of people who did not share her sense of the moment's value. Dickinson continued to see a few close friends, the people she considered worthwhile and who had some appreciation of her work. She also longed for a real intimacy, but her demands were intense.
She would write letter after letter, belaboring her correspondence to write her back, page after page, marvelous stuff. Well, their wits failed. They couldn't do it.
You know, these letters written in an anonymous way that demonstrate the writer's brilliance, the stylistic brilliance, rather than attempt to communicate to any particular person. So getting a letter from her would be like getting a riddle, you know, a tough nut to crack. Getting a letter from Emily would be delightful in one sense, but in another sense, one could get impatient, wondering what she's really talking about.
My friends are my estate. Forgive me, then, the avarice to hoard them. They tell me those were poor early have different views of gold. Our pastor says we are a worm. How is that reconciled? Vain, sinful worm is possibly of another species. Do you think we shall see God? Think of Abraham strolling with him in genial promenade. On subjects, or should I say beings, about which we know nothing. We both believe and disbelieve 100 times an hour, which keeps believing nimble. You ask of my companions, hills, sir, and the sundown. To shut our eyes is travel. The seasons understand this. Nature is a haunted house, but art, a house that tries to be haunted. A letter always seems to me like immortality, because it is the mind alone without corporeal friend.
As she grew older, her friendships failed more often than not because people couldn't stand the pace. She asked too much and found again that perhaps the best thing for her to do was to select her own society, as she said in a famous poem.
But I think this is meant to be a parallel to the question of the elect of God. So that what the soul does in choosing its friends is very much what the deity does in discriminating between the saved and the damned. And there's something very frightening about that when we think of how ruthless we are about who our friends and enemies might be, at least inwardly. We are performing an act which is the same act that God performs when he cuts us off from all hope of salvation. The poem, I think, hovers on the brink of those curious mysteries which are interior and psychological, but are also exterior and theological. And she seems to me very often playing with those puzzles that parallel one another but are not exactly the same.
The soul selects her own society, then shuts the door to her divine majority. Present no more. Unmoved, she notes the chariots pausing at her low gate. Unmoved, an emperor be kneeling upon her mat. I've known her from an ample nation. Choose one, then close the valves of her attention like stone.
There were moments when Dickinson could revel in her autonomy, or at least accept the price she paid for it. But no one has better described the anguish that comes with the withdrawal of love. It is impossible to know whether Dickinson is addressing God, or a human lover, or an imaginary lover, or speaking about being a poet.
I am older tonight, Master. But the love is the same. So are the moon and the crescent. If it had been God's will that I might breathe where you breathed and find the place, myself, at night, if I can never forget that I am not with you and that sorrow and frost are nearer than I, if I wish with a might I cannot repress that mine were the queen's place.
They're looking for a romance. They're looking for an identifiable person with whom she is supposed to have fallen in love and whom she's supposed to have renounced and for whom she is supposed to have gone into seclusion. This myth-making really does not take account of her, the poet, Emily Dickinson, the poet, and her needs.
Oh, I think she probably had several romances. They may have been rather like infatuations, but very deeply and passionately felt. She refers to some men as master, and it's fairly clear that's not the same man. Samuel Bowles has been advanced as certainly he was one, and there were others. But I think, in a way, it's probably not important. They were like male muses to her, and she wrote to them.
You have the most triumphant face out of paradise, probably because you are there constantly. Instead of ultimately. Not to see what we love is very terrible, and talking doesn't ease it, and nothing does, but just itself. The eyes and hair we chose are all there are to us. Isn't it so? I often wonder how the love of Christ is done when that below holds so. Wild nights, were I with thee, wild nights should be our luxury. Futile the winds to a heart in port, done with the compass, done with the chart. Rowing in Eden, ah, the sea, might I but moor tonight in thee.
It's perfectly clear that in her poetry she often felt that she'd given up a normal existence as a woman, even in some ways a normal existence as a human. She saw very few people, and she behaved very oddly when she saw them. She was very intense and very hard to talk with, someone who clearly did not put people at ease. Colonel Higginson, in his first interview with her, described the effect as absolutely exhausting. Now, this is a military man. He's, I'm sure, not easily exhausted. He could scarcely recover from that first encounter.
Colonel Thomas Wentworth Higginson was the first person outside Emily Dickinson's immediate circle to whom she showed her work. In 1862, he published an article in the Atlantic Monthly advising young authors how to break into print. Dickinson wrote to him, asking for a candid reading of her poetry, posing as a beginner even though she had written nearly 1,000 poems. they began a correspondence. Some years later, when Higginson first met her, he described the encounter in a letter to his wife. A large country lawyer's house, brown brick with great trees and a garden. I sent up my card. A step like a pattering child's, and in glided a little plain woman with two smooth bands of reddish hair, in a very plain and exquisitely clean white piqué and a blue net worsted shawl. She came to me with two daylilies, which she put in a sort of childlike way into my hand and said, "These are my introduction," in a soft, frightened, breathless, childlike voice, and added under her breath, "Forgive me if I am frightened. I never see strangers and hardly know what to say." But she talked soon, and thenceforward continuously, sometimes stopping to ask me to talk instead of her, but readily recommencing. Colonel Higginson, however, was baffled by Dickinson's poetry, and discouraged her from trying to publish it.
Dear friend, I smile when you suggest that I delay to publish, that being foreign to my thought as firmament to Finn. If fame belonged to me, I could not escape her. If she did not, the longest day would pass me on the chase. You think my gait spasmodic. I am in danger, sir. You think me uncontrolled. I have no tribunal. I had no monarch in my life and cannot rule myself. And when I try to organize, my little force explodes and leaves me bare and charred.
She chooses to have it out at last on her own premises, which was certainly an act of rebellion as a woman in 19th century New England, as it is still, to recognize and acknowledge our own interior power has always been a path mined with risk for women. The feeling of being unsexed, of being unwomanly, of breaking taboos, of being unnatural, of being alone.
I cannot live with you. It would be life. And life is over there, behind the shelf the sexton keeps the key to, putting up our life, his porcelain, like a cup discarded of the housewife, quaint or broke. A newer Sèvres pleases, old ones crack. I could not die with you, for one must wait to shut the other's gaze down. You could not. And I, could I stand by and see you freeze without my right of frost, death's privilege? Nor could I rise with you, because your face would put out Jesus, that new grace grown plain and foreign on my homesick eye, except that you than he shone closer by. And were you saved and I condemned to be where you were not, that self were hell to me. So we must meet apart, you there, I here, with just the door ajar that oceans are, and prayer, and that white sustenance, despair.
In 1861, the Civil War began. The local papers filled with battle reports and lists of casualties. That spring, Emily Dickinson had her first poem published in the Springfield Republican, whose editor was her friend Samuel Bowles. She had been working at a white heat, sometimes writing three poems a day. By 1862, she had written nearly half the poems in her canon and the great letters she addressed to master. During this period of creative intensity, there was a crisis. "I had a terror," she told Higginson. "I could tell to none."
how does the person who lets herself acknowledge and go through and confront acute psychological distress and acknowledge enormous anger, terror, isolation, feelings of separateness, how does that person then have the self-possession almost to make of that a poem?
The soul has bandaged moments when, too appalled to stir, she feels some ghastly fright come up and stop to look at her, salute her with long fingers, caress her freezing hair, sip goblin from the very lips the lover hovered o'er. Unworthy that a thought so mean accost a theme so fair. The soul has moments of escape when, bursting all the doors, she dances like a bomb abroad and swings upon the hours. As do the bee, delirious born, long dungeoned from his rose, touch liberty, then know no more but noon and paradise.
Touch liberty, then know no more but noon and paradise. For all our talk of states of psychic extremity, she is a great poet of euphoria.
And the very drama of her poetry is the drama of what it means to be human, to swing from one mood, one state of consciousness to another, you know, absolute lucidity and good humor and wit, to despair. In a sense, as she says in several poems, really harrowing poems, that she's gone mad.
You feel about Emily Dickinson that there's something much more urgent impelling her. She's not being a poet. She is saying something which has to do with the very state of her soul and requires utterance at that moment.
After great pain, a formal feeling comes. The nerves sit ceremonious, like tombs. The stiff heart questions, was it he that bore, and yesterday or centuries before? The feet mechanical go round, of ground or air or aught, a wooden way, regardless grown, a quartz contentment like a stone. This is the hour of lead, remembered if outlived, as freezing persons recollect the snow. First chill, then stupor, then the letting go.
Emily Dickinson had a history of eye trouble which has never been explained. It may have been a symptom of Bright's disease, the kidney ailment she died of. Whatever the cause, she lived in dread of losing her sight. By 1864, it was imperative to consult a specialist in Boston. Dickinson left Amherst for 7 months, the longest period she had ever spent away from home. The following year, she underwent another 6 months treatment. When she returned from Boston, she was never to leave home again.
I don't think she has any heirs or heiresses. I think that she's on N-stop. One can see certainly that the precision of images and some of the preoccupations with mental states of extremity maybe picked up in Sylvia Plath and Marion Moore and Elizabeth Bishop and the early Anne Sexton. I think we can see that. And she has influenced people in ways perhaps, you know, too nebulous to state.
I think I came to her poetry very late, because those early poems that were popular with the public were some of the coyest and most girlish, like I'm Nobody, Who Are You? Those had their sort of general appeal, but the more interesting and penetrating poems of hers were really almost unknown at that time. And then the great Johnson edition came out, and that was a kind of revelation all by itself.
It was not until 70 years after her death that Dickinson's poems were published in the form the poet intended. All of the early editions were altered to conform to prevailing tastes. She had written almost 2,000 poems. When she died in 1886, her sister Vinnie found the manuscripts in a drawer in Emily's room. She had stitched them into small packets, giving an order to the 18 or 20 poems that each contained. But she never provided a date or title. In 1890, Colonel Higginson and Mabel Loomis Todd, a family friend, prepared the poems for publication, choosing the lightest and most conventional, adding titles, editing the language, changing punctuation that they thought too oblique. But it was not until 1955 when Thomas Johnson published all the variant readings in three volumes that the authentic Emily Dickinson was finally offered to the world.
I'll never forget the shock of opening the second edition of her poems in which the dashes had been restored. The dashes and the capitalizations had been restored. And getting a sense of a whole new reading of this poetry, a whole new voice, much more jagged, much more personal, much more original, much more uncontainable than I had ever thought her to be.
What she tells us is, again and again, what it feels like to be alive. And that is her gift. It's a steady march and a pilgrimage, I would say, toward some kind of unity, some kind of belief, something that would bring the whole thing together. She called it, in a word that she was fond of, circumference. My business, she said in a letter, is circumference.
Dickinson's sense of self was greater than the pressures, crises, losses, and fears that tested it. She struggled for and invented a language of experience adequate, one of her favorite words, for expressing life's complexity. That, she believed, is what we need poets for.
To be adequate, to be erect, to be equal to the task at hand, equal to the living of her own life, to be erect, non-submissive, head not meekly bowed, you note, erect and crowned. I think that posture was very important to her.
The props assist the house until the house is built. And then the props withdraw, and adequate, erect, the house support itself, and cease to recollect the auger and the carpenter. Just such a retrospect hath the perfected life, a past of plank and nail, and slowness, then the scaffolds drop, affirming it a soul.